Don't be anxious about anything.
Anything? Is it really that simple?
I'm on edge all the time. I know the King of all kings. I'm friends with the Creator of all mankind.
But I still can't calm my anxious mind.
It's universal, and to every single person it applies. I try to face it down, to look it dead in the eye. Sometimes I run, but it always seems close by.
I'm anxious about my anxiety. I do my best to deny, to pretend that everything is fine. Don't worry about me. I'm just a little shy.
No one can know the anxiety dial of my life is turned up high. It'll be another sleepless night.
I lay in bed staring at my phone. I don't want to turn it off, because here's what I know.
Anxiety grows in the dark.
Anxiety grows in the dark when you're all alone.
The weight is heavy. It's too much for me to bear. Then I hear God's word whisper in my ear, cast it all on me.
Cast it all on me, because I really do care.
So the boy looking down with the dark circles under his eyes, he acts like he doesn't care, but he wishes someone would at least try.
To the girl crippled by past betrayal, she's become a slave to the weighing scale.
To the man who finds numbness at the bottom of his bottle, his tortured eyes show the fear he hides, the pain he continues to swallow.
To the woman who stares at a wall while she sits at a shelter, she married a predator, the man she thought would protect her.
If faith that conquers fear is what you lack, then cry out for help as you fall on your knees.
For the Lord does not slumber, nor does he sleep.
And at the very sight of him, every fear will flee.
Anxiety may be part of humanity, but God has seen my vulnerability.
He is undefeated, unchanging, and unchallengeable.
He is for you, so that makes you untouchable.
Untouchable.
Don't be anxious about anything. Cast it all on him. I mean everything.
Everything.
Let's pray. God, I thank you that we can come in here today with whatever weight we've been carrying, and we can transfer it to you. God, that we can cast our anxiety on you because you care for us. You really do care. And if we could believe that, if we could get our arms around that, so much of the anxiety that we feel would melt away. Lord, we live in a world that is increasingly on edge, it seems. Lots of anxiety and stress and just feelings of being overwhelmed. Would you help us, God, to experience your peace before we leave here today? Would you help us, God, to realize that you give it to us supernaturally? It's something that can't fully be explained or understood, but it meets us in the storm and calms us. I pray that you would let us know that. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I don't know if you do your reading on a Kindle or maybe iBooks, but there's this feature that allows you to highlight certain sentences that you want to remember, you want to recall in the book later. So you can click on a button and it'll just put on a page all the different sections of the book you've highlighted. It's a great tool. What you may not know is that they keep track of that. They keep track of how many people highlight what parts of what books. And so you can actually see what book has been highlighted more than any other book. And it's interesting that the one section that's been highlighted almost 2-to-1 more than any other book comes from the Hunger Games novel, part 2. Here's the sentence, been highlighted more than any other, because sometimes things happen to people and they're not equipped to deal with it. Sometimes things happen in life and you're not equipped to deal with it. I imagine people reading the book, deciding to highlight that sentence. So it's a student who feels overwhelmed with school. It's a young lady who's trying to process a breakup. It's a young man who knows he can't go back next semester. It's a wife whose husband has had an affair and she's trying to just get lost in the pages of a novel, and they come across this sentence and without even thinking, they highlight it. Sometimes things happen and you're not equipped to deal with it. I was reading in the book Worry Less, Live More by Robert Morgan about the most highlighted passage of scripture in the Bible. You might think it's like John 3:16 or the 23rd Psalm, but the most highlighted passage of scripture is the passage we're studying today, Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. Here's what it says. Don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, and with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Isn't that interesting? Let me just put those two pieces of information together for a moment. that the most highlighted section of any book is a passage that says, sometimes things happen in life that you're not equipped to deal with, and the most highlighted passage of Scripture is, don't be anxious about those things. When things happen in your life and you're not equipped to deal with them, don't be anxious, but in everything through prayer and petition and with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And so this is God's word for a very real and relevant challenge that a lot of us have, just feeling on edge and overwhelmed because there are things that are happening and we don't know what to do and we don't quite know how to deal with those things. That phrase, peace that passes understanding. In some ways, that's a challenging phrase for a communicator because what it's really saying is there's a peace that can't be communicated. There's a peace that comes from God that can't be understood. And if it can't be understood cognitively, then the person who's trying to explain it has a tough job ahead of them, right? And yet this is a peace of God that I've seen. I've experienced it on some level. And as a pastor, I've witnessed other people when they have felt it in their storm. Some of you would testify to this, that there's a peace of God that you didn't quite know about until you found yourself in a storm that you didn't think before going through it that you could get through it. But in the middle of it, God's peace met you. And it's not that life was just perfect and that there were no challenges or worries. It's not that you didn't have moments of panic or despair, but you found a supernatural peace that sustained you, and it was more than you would have had on your own. So on Thursday of this past week, I'm talking to a mom and dad who lost their 18-year-old daughter on Wednesday. I'm listening to them, and this young lady was beautiful, and she was smart and kind and sweet, and she had just been accepted into the genetics program at Clemson. She had a bright future. She loved Jesus and she loved people. And I'm just listening to mom and dad talk and I'm wiping tears off of my cheeks as I'm on the phone because I got an 18-year-old girl. I don't know what I'd do without her. I can't imagine what it would be like to lose her. And so I just can't quite wrap my arms around what they're going through. And yet the promise I claim on their behalf and the promise I believe is what's found here in Philippians 4, that there is a peace that passes understanding and it will meet you in your darkest place. It will sustain you. And it can't be drummed up just from digging down deep and looking on the inside. It's from God. It's from God. It's supernatural. And so Paul in Philippians 4 talks to us about how we find this kind of peace in the midst of anxiety. I want to talk to you for a few minutes about just some of the anxiety we deal with, but I've tried to separate these categories over the last couple of weeks because it seems dangerous, right? Like you come to church to hear about anxiety and the preacher gives you all the reasons you have to be anxious. Have a good afternoon. See you next week. I don't want to do that. Like I don't want that to be the spirit of this. So we talked about some last week. We'll talk about some this week. I've tried to keep these categories general rather than specific, again, for the same reason. So one category of anxiety would be what I would call the unknown, the unknown. So much of anxiety revolves around the what if question. What is gonna happen tomorrow? What does the future hold? And that can be big questions, right? Like, what if there's another terrorist attack? What if the economy collapses? What if I never find someone to spend my life with? What if we can't get pregnant? What if our marriage doesn't make it? What if I can't get a job? The list just kind of goes on. It's the what if question. Jesus addresses that in the Sermon on the Mount from Matthew 6, and he says, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. And so a lot of our anxiety comes from what if. It's under this category of tomorrow. It's nothing that's happened yet, but we just can't help but think about the possibility of it happening. So another category that I would throw out there would be the unlikely. Things that are unlikely to happen, but they start to consume our thoughts. We live in a world, you know, for better or worse, we've got this 24-hour news cycle. Are constantly aware of what's happening around the world. I don't know if your phone works like mine, but I don't know if you've got your anxiety feature turned on where that just gives you the news in real time. Like, here's everything bad that's happening right now. And it pops up and tells you, have a good day. Just wants you to be aware of what could possibly go wrong for you later today. And so it's just constant updates of things that are going wrong for other people around the world. And the reason it's newsworthy is because it's unlikely. Like, if it were to be likely, like if it was a normal human experience, they wouldn't report it. But we're surrounded by this information. And it creates anxiety. Ecclesiastes 1:18 addresses this. It says, "For in much wisdom is much grief, and he that increases in knowledge increases in sorrow." There's a sense in which the more information we have, the more data we have access to, the more we're aware of what we have to be anxious about, no matter how unlikely it might be. In fact, some of the news stories aren't even real stories, right? It's like the whole category now is the fake news. If you saw on the news this week, Facebook is in, you know, some trouble for not properly regulating fake news, things that are just obviously fake. I started looking at some of the fake news headlines from Facebook over 2017. There's stories that were clicked on millions of times. People read it, they thought it was a news story. So like this one, Charles Manson to be released on parole in Johnson City, Tennessee. That's interesting, unless you live in Johnson City, Tennessee. And then you start to get pretty anxious, like everyone starts to look, is that him? It looks, that guy looks a little Charles Manson-y. You feel this anxiety. Another fake news story, weapon-toting clowns go on murderous rampage. Do you remember hearing some of these news stories? And people were anxious about clowns for a while. Then there was a follow-up fake news story to that one. Congress passes law authorizing citizens to legally shoot and kill suspicious clowns. So I don't know how you feel, but like for me, if anytime I see a clown that's not in a circus, that's suspicious. Like if there's somebody full on clown costume in here, I mean, I'm sorry. Like it just feels... That seems suspicious to me. And so you start getting anxiety over clowns. One of my favorite fake news stories would be this. 1.2 million people read this news story. Elderly woman accused of training her 65 cats to steal from the neighbors. And now you see a stray cat on your property and you just wonder, right? Like the remote control's missing and you can't help but think that maybe you're neighbor lady with all the cats has been up to something. You didn't misplace it, but you just have this anxiety over things that aren't even real. Right? We're surrounded by that kind of information. One other category that I would throw out there would be the uncontrollable, things that are outside of our control. An expert in the field of anxiety, of handling stress, Dr. Edward Hallowell, has this equation for anxiety. He says anxiety takes place when there is a heightened sense of vulnerability and a diminished sense of power. So when you find yourself in places where you feel vulnerable, but you don't really have much power to do anything about your vulnerability, then that creates anxiety. You're vulnerable, but you're not in a position to control things. So for me, when I read that equation, that definition, my mind immediately went to one of the things I'm doing these days is teaching my youngest daughter, my 16-year-old, how to drive. To me, this is the definition of a heightened sense of vulnerability and a diminished sense of power, right? Like I'm sitting in the passenger seat and I don't want to sit in the passenger seat. I don't want her to drive. I want to drive. And so she's doing good for the most part. She sometimes, though, gets her direction's confused, meaning like you say right and she goes left, which is problematic at times. And so I will sit in the passenger seat and my voice goes up 3 octaves and I'm white knuckling it and I'm slamming on imaginary brakes that aren't on the passenger side of the car. And it's because I don't have control. I don't have control. I wanna be in control and I'm not. I feel vulnerable. I'm buckled up, but I feel vulnerable and I can't do a lot about it in that moment. That's anxiety. And so for many of us, this describes how some relationships work, describes how we feel about a job situation. It describes the kind of the position we're in as we look to the future. We feel like we're going for a ride and we're vulnerable, we're exposed, and there's not a lot that we can do about it. You've probably heard of the prayer of serenity. It's been around for quite a while. It's oftentimes used to help people in recovery. It goes like this. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change and the courage to change the things I can and the wisdom to know the difference. But this is where oftentimes anxiety or peace gets determined. Do I know the difference between the things I need to accept and the things that need to be addressed? So I feel anxious maybe about some finances, and there's some things about my finances that I can control, but there's some things I can't. And maybe you feel anxious about your health, and there's some things you can control about your health, but there's some things you can't. Or maybe you're struggling with anxiety in a relationship because there's some things you want to control, but you can't. And you think if this person would respond this way, if this person would react this way, then I would have peace in my life. And you're trying to control how they respond and how they react. And the more you control, the less they do it, the less they move in your direction. You want to control the way someone feels about you. And you think, well, if he felt this way about me, if she felt this way about me, then I wouldn't have anxiety. So you try to control their feelings. And the more you try to control their feelings, the less they feel the way you want them to. And the less they feel the way you want them to, the more you try to control how they feel. And it just, the anxiety starts to blow up, right? And there's just so many things that we don't have control over. The Prayer of Serenity goes on to say, living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardships as the pathway to peace, and taking as he did, as Jesus did, the sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that he will make all things right if I surrender to his will, that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with him forever in the next. So God, help me with this. Help me to accept some things the way they are, not as I would have them to be. God, help me to be reasonably happy in this life, but to know that supreme happiness will come in the next. But that's hard for us. So we're anxious. So how do we deal with that? What do we do? Paul's gonna give us some things that we can put into practice. What I wanna touch on here is that, that for many of us, you know, increasingly so in our world, we look less to a scriptural solution for some of these things than maybe what was done in the past. And so last week I gave some disclaimers, you know, talking about how sometimes anxiety, not often, but sometimes it's physiological. It requires some professional help, some medicinal help. But too oftentimes we look to those sources and we don't look to what God has said. And God becomes kind of this last resort. Well, if nothing else works, maybe I'll look to God. I was reading in an article in the Atlantic magazine called Surviving Anxiety by Scott Stossel. He talks about just living with a lot of anxiety. He says, here's what I've tried as a way to deal with it. And he gives a list: individual psychotherapy, family therapy, group therapy, cognitive therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, rational emotive behavior therapy, acceptance and commitment therapy, hypnosis, meditation, role playing, exposure therapy, massage therapy, self-help workbooks, acupuncture, yoga, stoic philosophy, and audio tapes I ordered off late night TV infomercials. He goes on to give medications that he's on or has been on in the past, and I can't pronounce about half of them, so I won't try, but there's like Thorazine, Desipramine, Nardil, Buspar, Prozac, Zoloft, Paxil, Wellbutrin, good luck with the sign language on this. Cymbalta, Inderal, Cirax, Syntrax, St. John's Wort, Xanax, Valium, Ativan, and again, a bunch of others. Also, beer, wine, gin, bourbon, vodka, scotch, and there's that list. And then he concludes the article with, and here's what's worked. Nothing. And so I think oftentimes we turn to God as a last resort. And what I believe is that no matter where you're at on this anxiety spectrum, that there's a deeper level of peace that you can experience that comes from God, that's supernatural. So Paul says in Philippians 4, first to pray about everything. Verse 6, he says, "But in everything by prayer and petition and with thanksgiving, present your requests to God." He specifically gives us two kinds of prayer here. He talks about thanksgiving and prayers of petition or supplication. So here's why that's important is for many of us who've tried to cast our anxiety on God, we have found ourselves in this position where we're praying about our anxiety. We're making a list. God, here's all the things I have to be anxious about. And somewhere in the middle of the prayer, you realize I'm more anxious now than before I started, right? Why is that? It's because it's not just telling God about your anxiety. There's a certain way to pray here. It's praying with thanksgiving and gratitude. One of the things anxiety does is anxiety blinds us to blessings. It keeps us from having a perspective of gratitude. And it puts this disproportionate emphasis on things in our life that we wish were different. And so it blinds us from blessings. Now, other people might look at our lives and say, why are you so stressed out? Why are you so anxious and irritable and overwhelmed? You've got so many things in your life to be thankful for, but you don't see them because anxiety blinds you to blessings and puts the emphasis on what you wish was different. And so Paul says, pray then with thanksgiving, where you're paying attention to the blessings of what you have to be thankful for. And he models this for us. Philippians, he's not writing this text from the balcony of an all-inclusive resort in the Caribbean. He's writing this in a prison, chained to a guard, waiting to find out if he's gonna be executed. And that's where he's writing this from, right? So it's learning to be thankful, learning to be grateful, even when you wish there were a lot of things that could change. And then Paul also talks about praying prayers of petition. This is where we ask God for help. We ask God to intervene. So the idea here is that at some point, we stop telling God about our anxiety, and at some point, we start telling our anxiety about God. That's the idea. So David does this very well in the Psalms. You read through the Psalms, you'll see this shift where he begins a psalm by talking about the reasons he has to be anxious, and he has these enemies that are chasing him, and his life is in danger, and here's everything that's wrong. But then he shifts and he stops telling God about his anxiety and he starts telling his anxiety about God. He starts putting the emphasis on who God is and God's faithfulness and God's redeeming work and that he can have confidence in God's plan. And so that's the challenge. It's not just to pray about everything, but to pray in a way that relieves anxiety. One of the prayers that we should pray is to say, God, what do you want me to do about this? Right? Like sometimes anxiety or worry, it's like this flashing light on the dashboard of your life that says, this area needs some attention. And so you say, God, what do you want me to do? I've been casting my financial anxiety on you, but what do I need to do? And so maybe God would challenge you to put together a budget, to pay careful attention over here, to make some changes in a certain area of your life, or maybe that's true in your marriage. Say, God, there's a lot going on right now in my marriage. There's this anxiety. And God might say, well, have you been praying with your spouse? Or I know you're focused on some things that your spouse needs to do differently, but what about you? What about you, your life? What do you need to do differently? And so it's not just, God, here's my anxiety. It's, God, what do you want me to do differently? Or even as we talk about anxiety. You know, we have a class that we're gonna have at all of our campuses one night this week where we'll have professional licensed counselors come in and just talk about how we can deal with anxiety in a healthy way. There's information about that in your bulletin on the website, but the idea is that we wanna pray about these things, but sometimes the prayer we need to pray is, God, what do I need to give attention to? So Paul says, pray about everything, and then he assures them that in verse 19, that God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches, that God will take care of what needs to be taken care of. And so we learn then to turn to him first and foremost. So I want to be careful here, right? So I know that there are some people who need, in dealing with their anxiety, they need some professional help and therapy, and they need some kind of medicinal help. But First and foremost, my challenge would be that you turn to God, that you look to him for peace and comfort. That is, he's not a last resort. And so as you turn and pray to God, then God might open up some of these other doors that need to be addressed, some other things that need attention. But you turn to God first. In his book, High Society, Joseph Califano, who at the time was the chairman of the National Center on Addiction and Substance Abuse at Columbia University, here's what he says. He says, chemistry is chasing Christianity as the nation's largest religion. Indeed, millions of Americans who in times of personal crisis and emotional and mental anguish once turned to priests, ministers, and rabbis for keys to the heavenly kingdom now go to physicians and psychiatrists who hold the keys to the kingdom of pharmaceutical relief or to drug dealers and liquor stores as chemicals and alcohol replace the confessional as a source of solace and forgiveness. See what he's saying there? That our first turn increasingly is not to God, it's to, as he says, it's to chemistry. Now, we have to be careful not to pit these things against each other, which is sometimes what happens. That's not the idea here. The idea is that we turn to God first and foremost. One of the things I've learned is that, many people kind of reveal how they deal with their anxiety by what they have to do to get to sleep at night. And so someone is struggling with anxiety and they stare at a screen until they can't keep their eyes open any longer. And then at the last moment, they turn it off and set it on the nightstand and they fall asleep. Just this deep distraction. That's how they deal with it. For other people, it's, taking a couple of drinks, popping a couple of pills, it's going shopping online at Amazon, it's logging onto a pornographic website, it's turning to something or someone other than God as a way to deal with the anxiety you feel. So Paul says first you turn to God and you pray about everything, and then he challenges you, verse 8, to think about good things. Here's what he says. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Paul says, look, if you're struggling with anxiety, if you're having a hard time finding peace, then filter your thoughts through this list and just ask yourself, does this describe what I'm thinking about? Do I think about things that are lovely and pure and praiseworthy and excellent? And you filter your thoughts through that list and you find out that oftentimes, your thinking is determining your feelings. And if you took psychology 101, then you remember learning about cognitive psychology, that how we think, determines almost everything in our lives. That we sometimes dismiss some of that language in church because, the self-help movement and the power of positive talk, some of that stuff has become very humanistic, right? We put the emphasis on rescuing and saving ourselves. But the Bible goes to great lengths to talk about how what we think about matters. That as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. The Bible says, be transformed by the renewing of your minds. And so Paul says, look, when you're thinking, make sure you're thinking about these things. Now for some of you, that's hard because like the neural pathways in your brain are pretty well established and you kind of put everything down the neural pathway of criticism and negativity and doom and gloom, and that's just what you do. And so you shut that highway down. You open up a new pathway, new neural pathway called thanksgiving and praise and excellence, and you give your minds to those things. See, for many of us, we're guilty of living our lives according to fake news, right? But it's not necessarily on the headlines on Facebook. It's the headlines in our heads. It's these news stories that aren't real, but we just continually feed ourselves. And so if in your mind the headline is, life isn't supposed to be this hard, and you kind of wake up with that feeling and you go to bed with that feeling thinking, well, it shouldn't be this difficult. It's not supposed to be this way. Why is this happening to me? This isn't fair. If that's the headline in your head, then anxiety is going to be overwhelming. If you think, I would be content if he would do something or if she would do something. I wouldn't feel anxious if somebody else would change something about themselves. If that's the headline in your head, you're going to feel overwhelmed with anxiety. If you go to maybe a party or to a gathering and a friend doesn't talk to you for some reason and you walk away and the headline in your head is, why didn't she talk to me? There must be something wrong. There must be something wrong because she didn't talk to me. And that's the headline you choose. Then you're going to feel pretty anxious about that relationship when that may not be the case at all, right? So what we tell ourselves has a big impact. So Paul says, look, think about what's lovely and noble and right and admirable, excellent and praiseworthy. And then lastly, in verse 9, Paul tells us to live for God in all things. And he connects the peace of God to living God's way. Here's what he says. Whatever you've learned and received or heard from me or seen in me, he says, put that into practice and the peace of God will be with you. So he connects the peace of God to the way we live. You put these things that we're talking about into practice, you live according to God's ways, and you'll experience deeper levels of God's peace, that there's a connection there. You don't just get to live however you want to live and then expect to experience peace that comes from God. It's not how it works. So God says, you put others first. I put that into practice, and I don't live with the tense relationships. I don't live with the anxiety of, am I getting what I deserve, or what if somebody gets in line ahead of me? And God says to not covet, and I put that into practice. I don't live with anxiety then of jealousy or comparisons. God says that sex is reserved for marriage, and I live that out in my life, and I don't then live with the anxiety of emotional insecurity. There's a deeper peace that comes from a deeper intimacy. God says to be generous. I put that into practice, and I'm content. I'm not anxious over how much I have or don't have. By giving, I've taken money's power away, and anxiety goes with it. And God says to practice self-discipline. When I do that, I'm more likely to have habits that fight off anxiety. I'm more likely to not be anxious about things like paying bills on time or certain health-related issues. God says to regularly meet with his people. I put that into practice, and I'm surrounded then by other people who bear my burdens with me, people who encourage me along the way when I feel overwhelmed. God says to forgive, and I put that into practice, and then I live without the bitterness and the anxiety that comes along with anger and of being wronged. I don't feel anxious to even the score that I got to make somebody else feel the way they've made me feel. God says to worship him, and I put that into practice. And anxiety melts away as I remember who God is. I put God in his right place. In my research, I was intrigued by something I read from the American Heart Association. They're talking about how to live with reduced stress. And here's one of the suggestions they made. Examine your values and live by them. The more your actions reflect your beliefs, the better you'll feel. And so I think for some of us, this is really significant. That we say we believe in a God who is in control and a God who cares, but we've not aligned our life around that belief, and it's created a lot of anxiety. And we say we believe certain things that the Bible teaches, but we haven't aligned our life around those teachings, and that dichotomy has created a lot of anxiety. And so that's one of the challenges for us in the next few minutes. Is to take a look at what do I believe? What about my belief system needs to be addressed? And then once I address that, how do I align my life with what I've said I believe about God and God's word? As a church, I would love nothing more than for us as a community to be known as a community of peace and joy in the midst of sometimes difficulty and overwhelming challenges and circumstances. But that doesn't come because we drum it up. That comes from God. It's a peace that passes understanding. And I believe God wants you to experience that today. After I pray, we're gonna take a few minutes. We're gonna sing two or three songs. We're gonna worship together. I'd like to ask you in those next few minutes as we worship to engage some of what we talked about, to actively cast some of your anxiety on God, to experience the freedom that he wants you to have, to leave some things here before you leave, some of the weight you brought in, you're not gonna take it out with you. For others of you, if you need to make a decision, then you can come down front and you can meet me down there, talk a little bit more. But I just wanted this time of worship to be a time that becomes freeing for us as we remember who God is and we let him sit in the driver's seat. We release control. Let's pray. God, I thank you that you can do for us what we can't do for ourselves. And even now, God, I know that you know we can be in a hurry. We want to leave and we're kind of stressed out about you know the parking lot and driving and where we're going to eat. And Lord, would you just let us kind of take a deep breath here and put our attention on what really matters, that we could focus our hearts and our minds on you and your greatness. Lord, that you would give us that right perspective. God, I pray for my brothers and sisters who've walked in here today carrying weight that is too heavy, that you don't want them to bear. I pray, God, that they would release some things to you, that they would transfer it over to you, and that they would experience a deep and supernatural peace that comes from you alone. So, God, would you fill this place with your peace in the next few minutes? It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.